Good morning. Welcome to Lincoln Hills Community Church Online. Whether you are just across the street in a different city, in a different state, we are glad that you are a part of this church because we feel you are. Now, if this is the first time that you've joined us online, if you've been with us all along, we appreciate your participation because we believe that we are better together than we could ever be alone. And we would remind you to keep us in your prayers, because you are in our prayers. A couple of announcements. On July Sunday at 10 o'clock, we are opening up Lincoln Hills Community Church for a service that people will actually be invited to come. If you've looked at your email, you've seen that the sanctuary, we've social distanced our chairs, and there's room for 100 people here, and we're going to make an overflow ready for any people that would like to join us on the patio outside. And so it'll be a nice, warm summer morning to come back to church on July 5th. During this time, there is a most unique and difficult time that we're going through in our church, but I wanted to remind you that there's still some ministries that have an active part while we're going through this pandemic. The Helping Hands Ministry arranges for meals for those people who are going through difficulties, through illnesses, or bereavement. And we know that there's a number of you that would help anyone else. You'd give them the shirt off your back, but if you need help, you'd never ask. But that's not what this ministry is all about. This ministry is taking care of the family, the body of believers here. And so if you have a need, call the church office and we'll put you in touch with the Helping Hands Ministry. This week, we also want to celebrate that there are a number of couples that are celebrating their anniversaries. Proverbs 18:22 says, "He who finds a wife has found a good thing and obtains favor from the Lord." And these gentlemen that I'll be reading off today, they have found favor in the Lord. Our first couple is Bill and Lydia Bial. This week, they'll be celebrating 18 years of being married together. Ralph and Jane Madsen are celebrating 45 years since they said, "I do." Ron and Marilyn Berg are celebrating 60 years. That's 60 decades married together. Jerry and Joy Acoin, 64 years they've been married. There is an associate pastor at this church that isn't even 64 years old yet, and they're celebrating 64 years of marriage. Dave and Pat Becker will be celebrating 57 years of blessed wedding bliss. Don and Diane Lane, 64 years that they've been man and wife. Ed and Ricky Montoya are celebrating 42 years. Dell and Veronica Torres, celebrating 48 years. Norm and Sue Hill are celebrating 37 years married together. Now, I added that up. That is a total of 465 years that we are celebrating of marriage just this week. And so that ancient proverb is true. True love never grows old. Lisi, do you have an announcement?
Good morning, everybody. I'm here on behalf of Women's Ministry, and so I'm really speaking to the women of the church, okay? We miss you, and we bring you greetings. I'm sure that you miss being together as well, but the Women's Ministry Board met this past week trying to decide when we could meet again and what it would look like. However, we quickly agreed that we cannot do that. We can't set a date. There are too many unknowns in the future. So we just wanted to let you know that we miss you. And so I brought a rose from my garden today. And it's very beautiful, and it smells very good. But I wanted you to know that I would like to give a rose to each and every one of you, just as a reminder that we miss you, we think about you, and we do care that you stay safe And we hope that sooner rather than later, we can gather again, because we miss seeing each other, touching each other, and just being fellowshipping together. So please think of this rose as a reminder to stay safe and know that we care about you, and you can always call us. And also, I hope to see some of you anyway on the 5th of July when we reopen the church. Thank you. And now let us sing.
Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that you love us and call us your children. We thank you for the blessings that we've seen today and the hope that we have for tomorrow through your Son, Jesus Christ. We would invite your Holy Spirit to fill this sanctuary today. Be with our singers, our musicians, our technicians. Heavenly Father, be with our pastor as he brings the message that you have given him. We pray that you would give him wisdom and words rightly spoken to encourage and edify the body of believers here. And Heavenly Father, we would be so bold as to tell you thank you in advance for all that you're accomplishing today. For we ask it in Jesus' most precious, most powerful name. Amen.
Father, whose almighty hand leads. themselves, shall humble themselves and pray. If my people, which are called by my name, shall seek my face and turn from their wicked ways,
hope you'll join us as we do a responsive reading. I'll start, I'll do both parts, but we know that when we speak the Word of God, it means more than just reading it silently, and so we would invite you to participate in this responsive reading. No one has ever seen God, but God, the one and only who is at the Father's side, has made him known. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of all creation. He is before all things, and in him all things hold together, and he is head of the body, the church. He is the beginning and the firstborn among the dead, so that in everything he might have the supremacy. He was given authority, glory, and sovereign power. The Most High God is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and sets over them anyone he wishes. God exalted him to the highest place and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of those in heaven and on earth and under earth, and that every tongue would confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of the Father. Amen.
This morning, as we come to prayer, there's a number of folks that we would ask you to remember in prayer. And talked this week with Belinda Warner. And of course, Belinda has macular degeneration that has increased to the point where she is no longer able to drive, but she's doing well. And she can't drive, but she is driven by the Holy Spirit. She's a wonderful lady. Pray for her. J.D. Bruce is doing very well, recovering from the AFib. Medications are working well. And pray for his wife, Sandy, because while she's taking care of him, she had a fall and really sprained her wrist pretty badly. There's no break, but just keep praying for her. Joanne and Ed Bader. Joanne said, you know, she's still hanging in there. The numbers are coming down a little bit. Still on the chemo, but be praying for both of them. Rich Thornton, I talked with him, and his numbers have really come down. He's dealing with bone cancer. The treatment he's getting is really helping, so continue to pray for both Rich and Carol. Sherry Walker continues to go through infusions, chemotherapy, and her numbers are coming down, not as far as they want them to, but she's so upbeat about it, so keep praying for her. Ann McCarthy, Pastor Jody's mother-in-law, will be having some surgery next Tuesday, so please be praying for her. And I'd like to pray for Frank Erb today, one of our missionaries who works with the legislators in our state capitol. And as you can well imagine, this is a hard time for anybody that's in government. And Frank, God just affords a lot of opportunities to minister to those people. So I'm going to ask you for a moment to bow with me in just silent prayer, and will you pray for these folks as you're sitting there at home, and then I'm going to pray. Father, we know that you hear our prayers and you know the needs of every person here in our church and in our community. And we ask you, Lord, to touch them where there are bodies needing healing. Lord, touch their lives and bring healing to them. Where there are spirits that need to be encouraged, Lord, let the Holy Spirit, the great comforter, come to them and encourage their spirits. And Lord, as we live in a time that is unprecedented. We've never faced anything quite like this. We face an enemy we can't even see. We can't even necessarily fight. But Lord, it is a time that drives us to our knees, drives us to depend upon you in prayer. Lord, it's also a time in which we can easily be tempted to be angry and to hate and to become impatient. And Lord, it's in the midst of all this we ask you to put your arms around this nation. Hold us tightly in the grip of your hand, Lord. Call us to prayer as the song we sang a few moments ago, that if we would humble ourselves and seek your face and pray, you would heal our land. God, guide us through this time. Guide our government. Guide our leaders. Guide those, Father, who are making decisions and those who are guarding people's lives. Lord, may we remember we're called to do no harm. We're called, Father, to shepherd your people. Lord, in the scriptures, and especially in the Old Testament, you held your leaders accountable because they were shepherds to the people. Lord, guide us and guide our leaders and guide our nation. Lord, may your hand be upon us. May America exalt the Lord with all of her heart. Now we commit all this to you in prayer today and thank you that you hear us. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies. This morning, one of the things that I have a note to myself up here, because I do this every time I plan, and that is, it says, don't forget the Lord's Prayer. And I forgot the Lord's Prayer again. And my first slide this morning will be, when's the last time you were truly frightened? I got to tell you, I've been frightened all week that I'm going to do this, because you may not realize this, but I do this all the time. I get so caught up in praying that then I just close the prayer in the name of the Lord, and then I forget. So if you will forgive me, and Karen on the way up here says, you forgot. And that's all I've talked about all week, is my fear that I would forget. See, there's the sign, but I didn't look at it. Well, anyway, I want us to pray together anyway. This is Jesus' prayer, model prayer that teaches us how to pray. And as I think about praying together as a church family, and even now as I'm looking at this message we're going to look at in just a couple of moments, oh, how we need to pray for our Father's will. So join me this morning as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. It's your kingdom and your power and your glory forever and ever and ever. And oh, how we need to remember that as we pray and as we live every day of our lives. We're coming to a passage today that's been on my heart for more than just a few weeks. It's a passage in the book of Daniel. If you have Bibles at home, a lot will be on the screen, but you may want to turn to the fifth chapter of Daniel, because it's here in this chapter that we discover that there are kings and leaders sometimes who totally forget that God is in charge. He is the appointer of all who are in roles of leadership. And I want to say to all of us up front today, you and I may not be leaders at the national level, a state level, a city level, or even in Lincoln Hills, but we are all leaders someplace. We are leading someone somewhere. Don't ever forget that. And so what we're going to talk about here today is, oh, yeah, those terrible leaders who are in government and whatever. It's also meant to look at us. And there's some great lessons to be learned in this fifth chapter. When we come to it, by the time we get to it, Nebuchadnezzar is now dead. It's his grandson, Belshazzar, who is now on the throne. Interesting, Daniel 4 has this great chapter where Nebuchadnezzar is finally humbled, and I believe that by the end of it all, he came to a faith in the God of Israel, and he acknowledged who God was. But now, a few years later, he's gone. Now it's his grandson, Belshazzar. And the whole chapter is devoted to this debauched gathering that night and his total oblivion to the fact that his grandfather, great as he was, finally came to understand the greatness of God. I asked the question, when was the last time you were really frightened? Well, on this particular evening, I'm going to tell you, this guy was really frightened. This is Belshazzar. The night Babylon fell. And historically, it's interesting, we know that in one single night, the great empire of Babylon fell, and the Medo-Persians basically invaded. What happened was Cyrus the Great dammed up the Euphrates River that flowed right underneath the gates of the city and under the walls, and he marched in untouched, partly because everybody that should have been in charge was all drunk and sound asleep. But I'm going to look at this with you today, and I want us to look at it because there are some important lessons that you and I need to appropriate for our own lives and how we need to pray for our own country. Well, it begins by Daniel chapter 5. And if you have a Bible, follow along with me. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles. He drank wine with them. And while Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, really it's his grandfather, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem so that the kings and his nobles, his wives and concubines might drink them. Now, this is an incredible gathering. Nebuchadnezzar totally sacked Jerusalem when he finally destroyed it, took all of the gold and the silver and all the various accoutrements that they used in their worship, and he took them and he put them in his own temple. Now, here's the one thing Nebuchadnezzar did. He kept them there. He never used them. But his grandson says, hey, get the gold and the silver goblets. Bring them over. Let's have a big drinking party. And they do. Now, that's not the worst part about this gathering. Do you notice the fact that it's their wives are there and their concubines? This was some stag party. And so they come together, and it goes on to say to us, the king and his nobles, his wives and concubines, they all drank from them. And as they drank the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver, of bronze, iron, wood, and stone. They're talking about the gods of Babylon. Then something happens. It says, suddenly the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it wrote. His face turned pale, and he was so frightened, I love this part, that his knees knocked. So together, they knocked together, and his legs gave way. The king watched what was happening, and his knees knocked. Guy was pretty frightened. Well, what happens? He calls in all of his counselors, his cabinet, all the enchanters, all the sorcerers, the astrologers, the diviners, and none of them could come up with a solution. There was writing on the wall. We'll look at it in a minute. None of them can tell him what it was about. Finally, it tells us in the 10th chapter, or the 10th verse, the queen, hearing the voices of the king and his nobles, and I think this queen was probably his grandmother, Nebuchadnezzar's mother, or wife, she came into the banquet hall and she said, oh, king, live forever. I think she, under her breath, she says, you idiot. Don't be so alarmed. Don't look so pale. Have a little nerve. There is a man in your kingdom who has the spirit of the living gods in him. Don't talk to these idiots here. They couldn't help you at all. But call Daniel. There is a man. Oh, king, the most high God. Daniel finally comes. And this is what he says to Nebuchadnezzar. O king, most high God, the most high God gave your father Nebuchadnezzar sovereignty and greatness and glory and splendor. Because of the high position he gave him, all the peoples of the nations and men of every language, they dreaded and feared him. But it also goes on to say this, when his heart became arrogant and hardened with pride, he was deposed from his royal throne and stripped of his glory. He was driven away from people and given the mind of an animal, and he lived with the wild donkeys, and he ate grass like cattle, and his body was drenched with the dew of heaven, until he acknowledged that the Most High God is sovereign over the kingdoms of men and sets over them anyone he wishes. But you did not honor the God who holds in his hand your life and all your ways. Therefore, he has sent a hand and has written on the wall an inscription. This is what was written, O king. Mene, mene, tekel, parson. Which interpreted as this. Mene, mene, notice he says twice, mene, mene. God has numbered your days, the days of your reign, and brought it to an end. Tekel, you've been weighed and found wanting. Parson, your kingdom has been given to the Medes and the Persians. And then it concludes by saying that very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain, and Darius the Mede took over the kingdom. Let's pray for just a minute. Father, as we look at this and what happened with Babylon, there's a lesson for us. Father, help us to learn the lesson personally, to learn the lesson so we know how to pray for our country, to pray for our land, Lord, today, let your Holy Spirit be our teacher. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to read to you something. Some of you may have heard this before. Back in 1996, January 96, a pastor by the name of Joe Wright of the Central Christian Church in Wichita, Kansas, was invited to come and give the invocation before the Kansas State Legislature. They were expecting a nice little polite prayer, and gathered legislators were not quite prepared for what they heard. And I'm sure that Joe Wright prayed over this for a long time before he prayed. I'm going to read to you his prayer. The late Paul Harvey read this on his program, and you know, the other side of the story, and he never had responses as much to this letter as he had anything he ever did. And let me read it to you. Wright prayed, "Heavenly Father, we come before you today to ask your forgiveness. And we seek your direction and guidance. We know your word says, woe on those who call evil good. But that's exactly what we've done here. We've lost our spiritual equilibrium and inverted our values. Lord, we confess we ridiculed the absolute truth of your word and called it pluralism. We worshiped other gods and we called it multiculturalism. We endorsed perversion and we called it an alternative lifestyle. We've exploited the poor and we've called it the lottery. We've neglected the needy and called it self-preservation. We've rewarded laziness and called it welfare. We've killed our unborn and called it choice. We've also shot abortionists and called it justifiable. We've neglected to discipline our children and called it building self-esteem. We've abused power and called it political savvy. We've coveted our neighbor's possessions and called it ambition. We've polluted the air with profanity and pornography and called it a freedom of expression. We've ridiculed the time-honored values of our forefathers and called it enlightenment. Oh, search us, O God, and know our hearts today. Cleanse us from every sin and set us free. Guide and bless these men and women who have been sent here by the people of Kansas and who have been ordained by you to govern this great state. Grant them the wisdom to rule and may their decisions direct us to the center of your will. I ask it in the name of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, our living Savior." Paul Harvey writes, or at least wrote, that he never had anything that he read with more overwhelming response. Unfortunately, the day of that Senate reading or that legislator reading, you had three members jump to their feet and indignantly shouted, "He can't talk like that." And one representative called the prayer gross, divisive, sanctimonious, and overbearing. And another one called it blasphemous and ignorant. That was in Kansas. But the same thing probably would happen in most states, if not all. Paul Harvey later on said the preacher told on him. Well, what was said about them, unfortunately, can be said about most of our nation. But since that program, they've had more demands for that prayer than anything they ever did. I mean, demands from around the world, from Mexico, from India to Mexico, Russia to Australia, all wanting to have copies of it. Why? Because deep at the heart of so many of us, we realize things are wrong, just as they were there in Babylon. I want to talk with you about that this morning. What was wrong there in Babylon? For one thing, it was a failure to exercise needed leadership. Leadership that would be responsible. And here's an interesting thing. This was not a surprise that the Medo-Persians under Cyrus were at their gates. Cyrus had been growing, and Cyrus was even predicted in the Bible long before this, by name in the book of Isaiah, which took place about 200 years before. And Cyrus came, and Belshazzar knew about this. He'd already lost a battle with them. They're in the area, so what are these guys doing that night? They're having a big party. There's a lack of responsible leadership there, not dealing with the problems, but even worse, a lack of moral leadership. I go back to that drunken, debauched party they had there. It's one thing to have this drinking party, and it's bad enough that they bring in the goblets, silver and gold, that had come from the temple, but to have the wives and the concubines there, a
concubine is nothing more than a kingly prostitute. They're just letting it all hang out, and nobody feels bad about it. There's no moral leadership there. This is what God says in Isaiah: woe to those who call evil good and good evil. Woe to those who are heroes at drinking wine and champions at mixing drinks, who acquit the guilty for a bribe and deny justice to the innocent. Does that sound a little familiar these days? You know, one of the tragedies, and this is unfortunately, you know, I'm not trying to put down our judicial system, because it's far better than anywhere else. Yet, nevertheless, it's all about money. The guy that has the money can buy the best lawyers, and they can get off. And the poor guy who just has the public defender doesn't have much of a chance. There's something wrong with that. That's what that's addressing. Nothing's really changed. Solomon said, there's nothing new under the sun. It's the same today. Proverbs 11:18 says, the wicked man earns deceptive wages. You know what that is? That's bribes. But he who sows righteousness reaps a sure reward. You know, I talked to Frank Irby. He's a good friend, and we've talked several times, and he talks about how hard it is for people who get elected. They come really wanting with good intentions. But the atmosphere is such that after, you know, it makes you believe that you're bigger than you really are. And then you've got all of the lobbyists and all the special interest groups that are whining and dining you, slipping it under the table money for you. It's tough. It's tough. It's not new. It's always been that way. That's what God is talking about here. Stop taking the dishonest money. Start seeking righteousness. Righteousness, God says, is exalting, is what exalts a nation. Proverbs 31, it says, speak up for those who cannot speak for themselves, for the rights of all who are destitute. Speak up and judge fairly. Defend the rights of the poor and the needy. You know, we see a lot of stuff going on in our country right now, and I would not profess to have an opinion on who's right and wrong. All I know is, and all I believe is, the problem in our country is it's not about what's just and righteous. It's about who's right and who wins. And that's what's wrong with our political parties. They can't get together and address evil and try to help do something about it. Instead, it's about losing your position, about egos, about pride, and about money. It's as old as the sin of man. Failure to reverence the holy. And, of course, that's obvious here what happened. You know, they bring in all these goblets and things that were part of the temple that even his grandfather had enough sense not to desecrate them. But now the grandson brings them. Oh, let's just have a big party. Who cares about God? You know, today in our nation, it's almost outlawed to have prayer meetings now, at least on the national level. And when we come to pray, and I'm grateful that I get called to the city council here in Lincoln, they still allow us to pray. But again, they prefer us to be a little bit general, and I understand that. But there is such a powerful movement to remove the whole concept of God from our national experience. There are those who want to take it out of the pledge. They want to take it off all of our money. They want to chip it out of the statements that are on the halls of justice and the legislature. We want to act like there's no God. You can't do that. Daniel says, while Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and the silver goblets taken from the temple of Jerusalem, so the kings and his nobles and his wives and his concubines might drink from them. It's a little bit like having the leaders all pray and have their perfunctory prayer, and then we set about robbing people of their rights and giving in to those who have bribed us. Daniel said, Daniel 5, it says, as they drank the wine, they praised the gods of gold and silver, of bronze and iron and wood and stone. What are the gods that people praise today? The gods of success, the gods of money, gods of political ambitions. You know, God wants to say, when will my people learn? The Lord said, I am the Lord. That's my name. I won't give my glory to another or my praise to idols. I've got to be number one. Then there's the failure, and I think this is the worst one. And this is something at every level, whether it's national, state, civic, or just in my own home. Failure to value humility. Obvious that was going on here. No humility. Babylon, the jewel of the kingdoms, the glory of the Babylonians' pride, will be overthrown by God like Sodom and Gomorrah in a single night. That's exactly what happened. That very night, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain, and Darius the Mede took over the kingdom. How important is humility? Well, Peter says many years later, all of you clothe yourselves with humility toward one another because God opposes the proud, but he gives grace to the humble. I find this rather interesting that he writes this because he's writing it in the midst of the Roman Empire and the Neronian persecutions. Terrible things are going on. Rome is debauched. And yet he's saying to all of the believers, be humble. God's opposed the proud. He'll deal with it. But pursue humility. Proverbs says he mocks proud mockers, but he gives grace to the humble. This is the one I esteem, God says, Isaiah 66. He who is humble, contrite in spirit, and trembles at my word. You know, in the midst of all of this, I think one of the good things maybe about the coronavirus and things like that right now is it humbles us. I know it frustrates people, but on the good side is I think it's terribly humbling because at least many of us realize how precious life is and how it's totally in the hands of God. There are things right now, they're out of my control. Yes, I can wear a mask, I can social distance, and I should do that, and I should wash my hands and all that kind of thing. But you know, you realize in the midst of all this, at least it does for me, it reminds me that life is a gift of God. And I need to treat it in genuine humility and thankfulness and not take it for granted. And those who get put into positions of leadership, wherever it is, should realize, humbly realize, that God has put that in your hands. Handle it with great care. Daniel 5:22, but you, O son of Belshazzar, you have not humbled yourself, though you knew all of this. And go back to that for a minute. He says, you knew all of this. What did he know? He knew about Nebuchadnezzar. He knew what happened to his grandfather. He knew the change in his life. You know, it causes me to think for a minute. It's like saying to all of us as Americans, you know the history of your country. You know how God brought us into being. You know the hand of God was there. We have not always been good, but God has responded to us when we humbled ourselves and we prayed over and over again. He's also taken us to the woodshed many times and spanked us because we needed it. Belshazzar, you knew all this and you didn't do a thing about it. That's a statement that worries me for America and anybody in leadership. God has numbered your days, your reign, brought it to an end. You've weighed and you've been weighed and found wanting. Your kingdom has been given to the Medes and the Persians. Well, how serious is all of this? I guess if you get the drift from me, my tone today, yeah, it is serious. But let me stress something to you. Where does this all come from? It begins with Satan himself. Two places in the Old Testament, God gives us in Ezekiel 28 about the career of Satan. Listen to what it says. You were the anointed cherub. That means he was the prime minister of all the angels. You were on the holy mount of God. You were blameless in your ways from the day you were created until unrighteousness was found in you. Your heart was lifted up because of your beauty, so I cast you to the earth. Isaiah elaborates with the five I wills that Satan said. You said in your heart, Satan, I will ascend to heaven. I will raise my throne above the stars of God. I will sit enthroned on the mount of the assembly on the utmost heights of the sacred mountain. I will ascend above the tops of the clouds. I'll make myself like the Most High. I'll be in charge. That was where it all began, with Satan. And we keep repeating it so easily in our lives. When leaders place themselves above the law and above the ways of God, they court judgment and disaster. And we're destined for a fall if we don't learn our lessons. Each one of us is a person of influence here today. You say, well, I'm not in an elected position. Well, you elected maybe to get married, you may be elected to have a family, or you elect to be part of a social group, whatever it is. Your life is influencing somebody, someplace. Each of us is leading someone somewhere. Question is, where is our life leading today? We honor the Lord's name. We humble ourselves before Him. And as the song we sang earlier, it comes from 2 Chronicles 7:14. I don't think we can remember this enough. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. I probably sound a little bit negative here today. I'm concerned, but you know what? I also believe that we have a God who will hear us if we do these things. It's been done before. It's happened before in our country, and we've turned. That's what we need to pray for. We need to pray in the midst of all this that God would remove this terrible plague, but that we also would not be ignorant of how He's trying to get our attention. In the end, my prayer is that we would all be able to sing this song. You know what? He is Lord. I thought about this as I was closing, and I kind of talked to Jim because I just want this song so permeates my being. And so you're sitting there at home, you're going to have to listen to me sing it right now. Oh, God forbid. But you can sing it right where you're at and mean it.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every shall bow, every tongue confess that Jesus Christ is Lord.
I want you to sing it again, and now I want you to say, you are Lord.
You are Lord. You are Lord. You are risen from the dead, and you
Lord, this is our prayer this morning. You've heard our hearts. Heal our land. God, give us great courage as we navigate through this pandemic, but navigate through all the social upheaval and injustices that have gone on or suddenly being brought to our attention. Lord, there's bad on all sides. God, give us the grace and the humility to work together and begin to solve the problems and heal our nation. Oh God, bless us right here where we're at. Make us a people who are in your hands, who are humble, repentant, and calling upon your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. May God bless you all and go in peace.